Hello, welcome to another edition of the Mike Zielinski Show. I am Mike Zielinski. I'm honored today. My guest is Dr. Travis Berger, who is an assistant professor of business and leadership at Alberta University. And he's also the founder and managing partner of Vide Consulting Group, a regional leadership and management consulting firm. Welcome, Travis.
Oh, thank you for having me, Mike.
You are a columnist for Business Weekly and the Reading Eagle. You had a column today, which, if we have time, I would like to touch upon as we tape this. But I really want to focus on, you had a three-part series on leadership in turbulent times.
Yeah.
And that really kind of resonated with me. I don't know whether I digested it at all, but it seems to be so critical. By the way, this was based on international leadership global conference you went in Brussels, and I know you enjoyed the Belgian beer. But let me ask you this. You cite an example like if you were in the taxi business and Uber, and I was in the newspaper business, and how turbulence and change, and like it's so imperative for businesses to listen and be aware of that. So if you could expound upon that, because, I guess you talk about you have to foster organizations that can listen to the world when necessary, challenge the status quo. So could you, amplify that a little bit?
Sure. Thanks for the question, Mike, and thanks for having me on.
You're more than welcome. Thanks for
honored to be here. So the point of that column with regards to turbulent times is, this disruption in innovation. It's not something that's new. It's not something that is startling. It is, right? So organizations need to be able to embrace that and think about that and always be reinventing themselves. So if a organization isn't a learning organization, which means it doesn't have the capability to listen to the external stakeholders, listen to the internal stakeholders, and to be able to forecast and foreshadow what are some things that are going to disrupt the industries, they're no longer going to be in business. And one of the things that organizations, for whatever reason, seem to be forgetting is that one of the most valuable assets that a company has are their people, right? The people that are on the front lines, the people that are in the business, the people that are doing the business every single day, they have their pulse on what's going on. So instead of doing all sorts of external assessments, a good starting point is to listen to your people and to ask them questions and to make sure that you're reinforcing to them that their input's valuable and they need to be understanding what's going on in the environment.
You talk about, organizational silence is a death knell for many companies. I want you to explain that, especially that you're supposed to encourage dialogue and debate, I get that, but also conflict, and the conflict I was wondering about. But let's start with organizational silence, just not being attuned to what's going on?
Yeah, so there's a lot of research, and through my own anecdotal experiences, sometimes you get to an organization and you're sitting at the executive table, and there's a bunch of nodding heads and a bunch of yes men who are only saying what is good to
be
heard.
In some organizations, though, that's kind of a matter of survival, correct?
Well, and that's going to be the
which is not the good leadership thing, but
correct.
But
which
it's
is
the reality,
is going to be their death knell.
Yeah.
So, what executive teams and a lot of executive teams are doing this extremely well. They need to be fostering dialogue, and by dialogue, it's honest conversation, right? And what happens is, if you and I were sitting down, we started talking about a point, right? It's not me arguing that my point is better than your point, that I'm smarter than you, and sometimes that's the dynamic that happens in those boardrooms, and that only leads to a win-lose scenario, and it comes from a very egocentric point of view. Whereas if everybody approaches a conversation, Mike, and they say, well, we're just offering our ideas and our thoughts and our best, right, analysis, and let's get everybody to have those conversations, and then if your idea or a chunk of your idea is better than or more useful than mine, that's great, because ultimately we're looking for what's best for the organization.
And for leadership to be open-minded and respectful of what people are saying and give them the freedom to say it without feeling there could be some retribution, correct?
Oh, well, absolutely.
That goes without saying, I guess.
Correct. So when I said the death knell, what I mean by that is everybody's just saying yes, and there's no There's no dissent. There's no opposing views. Nobody's challenging what people are offering. That's problematic. And somebody that's at an executive table, if you're not being challenged, you should be immediately raising a red flag and saying, I am doing something, my behaviors are doing something that are putting a kibosh on open and free dialogue.
Okay. Because you talk about, I get the encouraging debate and dialogue, but yeah. get to the conflict. How do you encourage conflict within a company to learn?
Well, so it's all about approaching, right, and how you frame different things is a big emphasis that I have in when I'm talking about leadership. So framing conflict. A lot of people think that conflict is bad and conflict should be avoided. But if you frame it as conflict is think about it as a positive, because out of conflict you can unearth some of these simmering type of issues, and out of conflict, you can come up with the best innovative ideas. Out of conflict,
oh, that's very interesting.
You can see what the root causes are. So that's why it's conflict management, right? It's not conflict avoidance. You want to have conflict, and anybody that's been in organizational life knows that conflict happens, right?
So
be a pro about it, right? Okay. Handle it like a professional. Understand that's not a personal attack, and let's see how we can use that to innovate and get better.
It's business, not personal. Let me ask you this. In part two of that three-part series from the Global Conference in Brussels, I thought it was really interesting. You devoted a whole column. You know, everybody talks about effective leaders, and obviously we need effective leaders and more of them. But effective followers, and it's not like followers are just sheep. Tell us about what makes an effective follower.
Yeah, so it's interesting. If I back up a second, whenever we talk about the concept of leadership, Mike, it's difficult because everybody has a lived experience with leadership, right? So you have your parents, so you have experience with leadership, good or bad, right? But you've had experiences, teachers, coaches, and then you get into the
work life.
Well,
back in the old days, some of those parents and teachers, they weren't exactly maybe the ideal leader type. They were very authoritarian, positional leadership, you know.
So then that's somebody's experience and exposure, right, to leadership and how they understand it. So when we talk about leadership, a lot of times people have preconceived notions of what leadership is, right? Yeah. So that's the personal component. And then you have all of the popular business books that are out there, Mike, right? So they're talking about, you know, the 21 irrefutable laws, and there's some merit in a lot of that work, but that clouds and clutters, right? So Barbara Kellerman, she founded the International Leadership Association, Harvard Business School, but she talks about leadership clutter. So this popular business books kind of add to the clutter around leadership, and then academic scholars were supposed to add.
Yeah, well, I was going to ask you the interfacing, right? The interfacing of the academic ideal aspect of it with a pragmatic, realistic business world.
Yep.
Sometimes there's not a chasm, but a little bit of divide that it's. A little bit different in the real world as opposed to the academic world?
Well, sometimes. So it depends. In business, I would say not, because a lot of business professors are pracademic. So they're in the practical world. They're doing a lot of stuff with businesses and organizations to keep their pulse on what businesses are doing. And they're trying to bridge the gap between what's happening in the research world. And that's not Ivy Tower stuff when we're talking about business research. It's taking ideas and being able to implement. The bridge there, Mike, that occurs is sometimes academics can use very esoteric and vague terminology, right? That's only very specific to the discipline. So how can we say that like regular people speak is the trick. So going back to your question, right, with regards to followers, where I wanted to...
We're not lemmings or sheep. Tell me about what a good, effective follower is.
That's right. So followers, when I was doing my research, came up with, took a lot of great work. So Robert Kelly in 1992 started his work on followership, and then Barbara Kellerman, and then Riggio. They all developed and have different taxonomies of followership, which is great. And I pulled a lot of that together, and essentially, followers, right, are engaged individuals that have integrity and critical thinking skills, and they have level-specific knowledge, skills, abilities, and behaviors that are going to allow them to be able to effectively support, right, a leader who then is using that to be able to positively impact the leadership process. And a lot of those are difficult, right? So by supporting a leader doesn't mean I'm just telling you that you're the greatest thing since sliced bread, that I agree with you. It's having the integrity to speak truth to power and say, hey, Mike, I don't think that this direction is really in the best interest of our organization, and having the ability to talk to somebody that has positional authority over you, that's not an easy conversation a lot of times, Mike, because there could be a lot of consequences of that. So when I'm talking about followers, right, people think about lemmings, and in American society, being a follower isn't sexy, right? You're not talked about. When's the last time you heard somebody say, we're going to school to become great followers? You don't hear of
but
that.
But they are, as you point out in that column, very critical to the success of an organization.
It is, absolutely. So the overall definition of leadership, Mike, is, right, it's a dynamic process that involves three different components, and those components are leaders. You need leaders, right? You just do. You need followers, though, which is another important variable, and then you need context. So it's how those
the context is the situation.
Absolutely, perfect, right? So internal, external, macro, individual, and it's how all three of those interact that allows people to create direction, alignment, and commitment, right? So an organization needs a direction. Everything needs to be aligned. People need to be committed in order to achieve.
And also, the followers, when they're respected and they realize they have a role with integrity and importance, does it give them even a higher motivation in terms of they know they have skin in the game, that what they do is crucial to success? They're not just following orders.
So absolutely. And I would take that a step further, Mike, is that people shouldn't be thinking of themselves as either a leader or a follower, because every day, from a CEO down to an individual level contributor, everybody is both a leader and a follower at some time throughout that day. So a better way to reframe
how... Of course, people say middle management is not the most ideal place because you get squeezed from the people above you and below you.
Well, that's where you have a lot of your functional experts, right? The people that can add real value, but you're right. They have directions from both. But to think of yourself as a high performer is super important. So when I'm leading, I'm adding the right things that would allow people to want to follow me to positively impact the leadership process. And when I'm following, I have the right skills and the right behaviors to be able to help, right, that support that leader to positively impact.
And this is, I don't know if this is a good example or not, but I come from the newspaper industry, and it always sometimes amuse me or confuse me. You could have someone who would be a heck of a writer and reporter. And so the model was, and they'd always get promoted to an editor's position.
Yep.
And they may be terrible people. They might have been a real good reporter, but terrible people person, a person without organizational skills. But that was that always basically happened, that a good reporter would eventually become a good editor, when in fact it probably was best for the organization for that person to remain a hotshot reporter and not screw up as an editor,
so,
or be a mediocre editor.
So this is a classic example. I'm glad you brought that up, right? Because some people, you used writing, so that's a good example. Sales, engineering, these are all great examples where
you can be a great salesperson, right, but not necessarily a great sales manager, right?
So what you do, so what organizations do, because they only have one track, right, for promotion, so that sales professional then becomes a sales manager, and now you've lost your best sales professional and you've just got a horrible sales manager, as opposed to having different functional tracks for promotion. So say you're an outstanding writer, right? And you decide that I don't want to go in the management, into the management track. Well, there should be, and I don't know in writing, right, what those steps would be, but like a writer one, writer two, writer three. And as you get to a certain level of expertise and knowledge, different things are expected of you, and you get promoted and you get remunerated accordingly.
Yeah.
Therefore, you don't lose your hot shot, I believe you used, your hot shot reporter, and they still are going to stay in the organization because they have a career path to be able to get promoted. But that's it's a classic example, right? And organizations don't think about strategic talent management. How are we going to grow and develop our people? And how are we going to take different areas to make sure that not everybody wants to go into management? So how are we going to retain our top talent here in a different track, right, that doesn't require the management track?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that is so true. Let's move on to the third part of that three-part series, which I thought was really interesting. The what, why, and how of leadership in turbulent times, and especially I was interested in the how of leadership. And you make a very good point that leaders are not always, leaders and leadership are not interchangeable.
Correct.
And that that leadership involves leaders, those dedicated followers and good followers, and context, situation. So could you talk a little bit about the how of leadership, and especially in why it's important in this era of turbulence time. You know, and all times are turbulent, but it seems like it's really going at warp speed with technology these days. You
know? Yeah, so Burns, George McGregor Burns in 1978 had a great quote. He said, we know all too much about leaders, but we don't know anything about leadership, right? And there was a difference between leaders and leadership, but that's changed. The research has really evolved, and we have so much to be able to go from, Mike. And what I was talking about there is, a lot of things are with regards to agility, learning agility. So you're taking what a situation is, right? Mm-hmm. And you're able to pull out of your toolbox the right style or behaviors or approaches that are going to allow you to be effective given that context and given your followers in that scenario. So you can't say, for example, that authentic leadership or servant leadership or one of the, 40 different theories or styles of leadership is the best, right? They all add value. So it's being able to know which one's going to be appropriate at the right, given the right situation. So it's having that awareness and having the ability to be agile between those different styles of leadership that's going to allow one to be a high performer and add real value.
Okay. I just thought it was very interesting. This week's Business Weekly was your column on servant leadership, which, to maybe a layperson like myself, that kind of sounds like a oxymoron, but it's definitely not.
Yeah.
And so you talk about the five bases of power: legitimate, reward, coercive, expert, and referent. And that these five bases of power help people secure either positional or personal power. People with positional power basically have the title, and their control is they can reward you or they can punish you. On the other hand, personal power is what? Derived from your skills and talents and is based on the strengths of your relationships. What is, and the first step in becoming a high performer, I guess, is to have all those aspects, but the servant aspect. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so it's interesting. The point of that article was people, for whatever reason, and probably rightfully so, they've had a negative experience with power, right? So power gets a bad rap. But power itself is neutral. It's why people want power.
I never really thought of it as neutral, but I guess it can be. It depends how you use it, right?
Exactly. Yeah. So power just is. It's the person that's pursuing power, right? You have to look at their intentions. Why do they want power? And then the second part is how are they using that power, right? There's called the influence tactics that they're using that leverages power. So how are they using power then makes it either good or bad. So the point of that is power is important. If you want to be able to make a positive impact, make a positive difference, right, in people's lives, in the organization, in communities, in order to influence others, you need those different bases of power, right? So you need to have expertise, you need to be able to have a referent base of power, and that's that personal side. But then you can't shy away either from titles, which are, right, legitimate right. power, and with that comes the ability to reward and coerce. And so the servant leadership component of that is really to help people think about why are you wanting power, right? Because not, if you're only wanting power to be able to, for selfish reasons, right, then that's probably not going to end very well for the people that you're influencing. But if you want power in order to positively influence things, then absolutely you need power. And people don't understand sometimes those different bases of power, and they have people doing things and they think they're doing it because they have a good relationship, but really it's because you have a title, right? I'm just doing it because I don't feel like getting fired. I don't feel like having a bad performance review. And so having an awareness of the different bases of power are really important for somebody that wants to be a high performer and wants to make a positive difference.
You say the great leader is seen as a servant first, and that simple fact is the key to greatness. And I get that if you're a minister or a bishop or something like that, but a business. Aren't they, what they're trying to do is serve their customers so the business can grow, and then in turn the employees have a better lifestyle? How do you reconcile just growing a business for the bottom line with being a servant? I mean, who are you serving? The customers, and then your employees along for the ride, or how is that?
Yeah, so there's a lot of research on servant leadership, right? And it's really a philosophy based on power, right? And how you approach power. But at its core, right, it's not just about serving customers, right? It's about how are you serving your internal customers? So that's your people.
Okay.
Because that's where a lot of these employee engagement and why employee engagement has become so powerful, Mike, and has become such a
Can serve your community. Doing a lot of good companies serve the community as well.
Right. So Absolutely. So a lot of people take what Robert Greenleaf, he coined the term servant leadership, and they focus on the individual, but he also talked a lot about institutions being servant institutions, right? So they're serving their communities. And, you know, with resources, there's nothing wrong with making a profit. If you don't make a profit, you're not going to be in business. If you're not in business, you're not going to be able to help people, and you're not going to be able to help that community. So it's just a way of reframing how you think about what your purpose is as an organization.
You know, you could correct me if I'm wrong. I would think a real key example, and he probably never read any of these types of studies.
Yeah, but not many people do.
Yeah, a classic example of a tremendous servant leader in Berks County, Albert Boscov, because he had a great focus on his customers, he had a great focus on employees, and obviously a great focus on the community. One of the reasons why he came back after his brief retirement, when Boscov's almost was liquidated, my wife worked for him for a number of years, closely with him in advertising, and never forgets the day when he came back and he had tears in his eyes and said, I'm going to restore all the jobs, and we will be back, and we will survive. And it was as important to him, his employees, as his customers, and his bottom line. And the bottom line was important to him.
Sure.
And but I just thought, when I read that column, I thought of Albert. Would you think that's a fair example?
Oh, it's an excellent example of a servant leader. And, you know, the point, though, is people have a built-in BS detector, right? So if somebody...
It has to be genuine, yeah.
Absolutely. So I thought that was a great story that you shared about Mr. Boscov when he came in. He had tears in his eyes, and he was like, we're going to restore people's jobs, right? We're going to get... That was his main focus. Yeah. Like, I don't want to have to lay people off. I don't want our stores closing. I want to bring it back so that we have impacting people's lives.
Yeah.
And if you positively impact your employees, they're in turn are going to treat the customers like you have treated them. And it's a great cycle, right? It's self-fulfilling kind of there in that circle.
As you know, we live in a superficial society.
Sure.
So let me ask you this. Does it help a leader be a better leader if he's charismatic, he or she, or good looking? Does that help someone better than, say, someone who is not attractive and maybe a little bit of a prickly personality? Because people judge people on a superficial level. Does it help you be a boss, a good leader, if you're good-looking and charismatic?
Well, so good-looking is different than charismatic.
Yeah, I know.
Right?
So they are different.
But
you can be charismatic and be ugly. But
you're correct, Mike. There's a lot of research that says people's first impressions, right, are made in the first 30 seconds. That people that happen to be better-looking, right, get promotions more often.
Or taller
right?
people sometimes get higher.
Yep. Right. right or wrong, that just is, and that's based on a lot of social science
human
research.
Nature,
so that's just there. But that's not delimiting, right? So that's not saying that somebody that is small or isn't blessed with good looks isn't going to be a impactful leader. That's just not the case.
But it probably helps them become more impactful, does it or doesn't it?
Well, so there's a lot of research that you would think that a charismatic extroverted type of individual is going to be the most effective leader, and the research is really coming out that a lot of the introverts, right, that really are able to listen and understand messages are able to connect with people better, and because they're able to connect with people better and they're better at analyzing situations, they're actually more effective at the enterprise level in leading organizations. So hopefully that answered somewhat of that question.
Oh, yeah, well, we're almost out of time. I just will say I thoroughly enjoyed this. It's been very educational to me. I'll give you a platform here since you were gracious enough to come on the show.
Sure.
For any company, someone who has seen this show or will see this show, who wants to get in contact with you about their organization? Vide Consulting has your own website, I assume.
Yeah, so we're in the process of revamping our website, but we have a website, and I'm active on some of the social media channels, LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook. So there's a lot of forums to be able to contact me, to be able to work with them.
Okay, and just so people know, who may not be old enough to remember, but this gentleman, Travis Berger, was a phenomenal high school soccer player at Wilson, later starred for Penn State. You were an academic All-American, and you played professionally with the Reading Rage.
Yeah.
So you've come a long way since you were kicking the ball over there in West Lawn, right?
I have, so thank you for mentioning that. Sometimes when you get older, you appreciate those accomplishments when you're a little bit younger.
Well, that's my sports background. I can't escape it. But anyway, Travis Berger, thank you
so much. Thanks so much, Mike.
Don't forget to support BCTV, and we'll catch you next time on The Mike Zielinski Show.